Good evening, everybody. Today we'll start food production and animal husbandry. In this chapter, you learn. Discuss about the principles of crop production. Explain the methods of crop production, including organic farming. Explain the methods of protection of crops from insects and weeds. Appreciate the value of animal husbandry, poultry, and fisheries as income generating activities. Give credence to the use of both modern technology and genetic engineering, thus removing the barriers between science and society in the process, and describe the link between production, storage, and distribution. So let us go back to the history of the agriculture, that is a green revolution. What do you mean by a green revolution? A great breakthrough was there. A big change related to crop farming and food production occurred in the Indian agriculture scenario, that is between year 1968 and 1988. This period has been termed the golden age of agriculture, named as green revolution. So during a period of between 1968 and 1988, there was a great improvement in the field of agriculture scenario. So this particular field was being noticed as a green revolution, means there was a revolution. What do you mean by revolution? A great change, we can say. A great improvement was there in a field of agriculture. So we call this period as green revolution. So we will understand the term agronomy. The most we already know the term agriculture. What do you mean by agriculture? That is a growing of crops in a large scale. We already know the term. Let us understand what do you mean by agronomy. The agronomy is the branch of agricultural science. It is a branch of agricultural science which is concerned with the crop production and management of the farms, is called as agronomy. So here agronomy is a branch of science, basically a agricultural science, which is concerned with the crop production as well as the management of the farms, is called as agronomy. Let us move to some principles of crop production. So first and foremost, during a crop production, we should follow some principles. That is, first one, maintenance of fertility and productivity of the soil. So basically, the soil should be fertile and we should see the productivity of the quality of the soil. So we have to maintain the fertility and productivity of the soil. Secondly, we have sowing healthy seeds in the field at the right time. So whenever we sow the seeds, we should see the seeds should be healthy. They should be of good quality. They should give a good yield. Such kind of seeds should be sown and they have to be sown at the right time. So sowing healthy seeds in the field at the right time. And proper arrangement for the availability of the water and fertilizers. Yes. So we should see that there has to be a proper arrangement for the availability of water. Say for example, this is nothing but irrigation. We should supply ample amount of water to the field, as well as we should see there has to be arrangement of fertilizers which provides nutrition for the growth of the crops. Selection of right crop types in accordance with variation in a type of soil and climate. So a farmer, not only he grow the crops in a field, he should also have a knowledge that which type of soil is required for a type of a crop. So the right selection of crop types in accordance with the type of a soil and climate is a very important principle during a crop production. Then we have crop harvesting at a suitable time. So always the crop harvesting comes at the end of the production. That is, we have to harvest the crops. What do you mean by harvesting? That is, collection of the crops from the field. It has to be done at a suitable time. Then scientific storage of harvest. So after the harvesting, the job becomes still more difficult for the farmers. He has to store them in a particular place, which has to be a scientific storage so that the crop should not deteriorate. There are most chances of deteriorating, that is, the losing the quality of the crops after harvesting. So they have to be stored properly. That is scientific storage of harvest. Then use of multiple cropping and mixed farming. So farmers should have a knowledge of what kind of cropping system should be used to utilize the complete availability of the lands. So they have to follow some of the cropping systems like multiple cropping and mixed farming. The farmers can also go for crop rotation. So to come out of the loss of some of the crops, they have to go for the crop rotation. That is another type of cropping system, that is crop rotation. Lastly, we have soil improvement and management. So farmers should learn how to improve the quality of the soil and how to manage the quality of the soil, because it is the soil which plays a very important role in a crop production. So he should have a knowledge of soil improvement and management. So these are the some of the most important principles of crop production. Now we will move to some of the methods of crop production. We learned some principles of crop production. Let us understand some of the methods of crop production. Like we have first one, that is a crop rotation. Secondly, we have mixed farming. Thirdly, multiple cropping, that is organic farming. So these are some of the four important methods of crop production: crop rotation, mixed farming, multiple cropping, and organic farming. So at the right side, you have a representation of in the form of a diagrams. Crop rotation, that is rotation of a crops takes place, mixed farming and multiple cropping. Lastly, it is organic farming. So let us learn in detail each one of them so that we will understand better. Firstly, we move to the crop rotation. Yes. What do you mean by crop rotation? Growing of crops in a predetermined sequence at a particular time is called crop rotation. Yes. So growing of crops, but it should be grown in a predetermined, that is one after the another. So we are rotating the crop in a form of a sequence. So in a predetermined sequence, and it should follow a particular time. So this kind of growing of crops is called as a crop rotation. So let us understand this with the help of an example, how exactly it is. Say wheat is planted in November. Okay, so wheat is a kind of a crop which is planted in November and cut in a March or April. It has been harvested. We can say cut in the sense it has been harvested in a March or April. Then rice is planted followingly, that is predetermined sequence we are telling, right? So we are following a sequence. So next in a sequence is rice. Rice is planted in June and July, and it is cut in October and November. So here we are following a determined sequence. How it is? First is wheat, followed by a rice. So we are rotating again wheat and then rice. So this rotation of a crops takes place. This kind of cropping is called as a crop rotation. So why do we follow this? Is because the soil that lies follow between these two grain crops is utilized by the farmers to plant the leguminous crop. So in between these two crops, you can see here in a diagrammatic representation at the down, right? So there is a gap between the two types of crops. You can say it is a follow, right? So this follow is being utilized by the farmers to plant the leguminous crops. Why leguminous crops? Is because leguminous crops always provide nitrogen nutrition to the growth of the other plants. In leguminous crops, there is a nitrogen fixation by the rhizobia bacteria. It is a kind of a biofertilizer. So this knowledge is utilized by the farmers. By growing the leguminous crops, both the wheat as well as the rice will get a free nitrogen nutrition by the help of leguminous crops. So this is an idea where the farmers will use the follow between the two crops to grow the leguminous crops. And why do they follow the crop rotation is because if any one of the crop will fail, the other crop may get a benefit to the farmers. So because of this, they follow the crop rotation. So we will see some of the advantages of crop rotation. Say benefits of crop rotation. Why do they follow crop rotation? Firstly, it maintains the fertility of the fields and affords soil nutrition due to abundance of nitrogen. Yes, it maintains the fertility of the field and affords the soil nutrition. As we already learned that the farmers will grow the leguminous crops so that it provides an abundance of nitrogen nutrition to the field. Secondly, it increases the crop production. Since we are growing two types of crops, so the different nutrients will be required. So there is no competition between the two crops for that nutrition. So it provides an increased crop production because of a crop rotation. Thirdly, it prevents the soil erosion because even a fallow is also being utilized for the growing of leguminous crops. There is no free soil. So this prevents what? Soil erosion. What do you mean by soil erosion? That is running out of a topsoil by the rainwater. Losing of a topsoil by the rainwater. Since the whole field has been covered by the plants, so there is no chance of soil erosion. Next, we have economical crop production. Yes, so it provides a crop production. Any one of the crops will surely provide the benefit. So it provides a economical crop production. Next, we have effective use of available resources. Yes, we are completely utilizing the land resources here, right? Since we are growing two different crops, so we are completely using the land resources. So effective use of available resources takes place. Control of insects and disease affecting crops. So by growing the different kinds of crops at the same time, so we can control the insect disease affecting crops. Lastly, we have regular income throughout the year. As I told you, we can get, since the each one of them are harvested at the different time. Wheat is harvested at the month of November, and the rice is been harvested at the month of July, right? So we have a different harvesting time. So we have a regular income throughout the year. So these are some of the important benefits of the crop rotation. The next important type of a cropping system, that is a mixed cropping. So we learned about crop rotation. Let us go through the mixed cropping. What do you mean by mixed cropping? It is the growing of two or more than two crops. It may be two or more than two crops at the same time in the same field. At the same time in a same field is called as a mixed cropping. So here let us understand in detail the differences between the crop rotation and the mixed cropping. In crop rotation, we were following a determined sequence, that is one after the another we were following, right? Whereas here we are cropping the more than two crops at the same time in the same field. There is no sequence. There is no pattern of sowing the fields. In mixed cropping, we are mixing the crops and we are sowing in the field, right? So this kind of cropping where we will grow two or more than two crops at the same time in the same field is called as a mixed cropping. See here in diagram we have,
right? So we have different types of crops, where each one of them are been separated by us only small amount of a distance, right? So here we don't have a specific pattern of sowing them. We don't follow a specific pattern of a sowing them. So this kind of cropping is called as a mixed cropping. Let us understand some of the advantages. Why do we follow this mixed cropping, right? The biggest advantage of mixed cropping is that the farmers get two crops simultaneously at one time, right? Or within a short interval of a time from the same field. Yes. So here there are more chances for the farmers to get the crops simultaneously within a short interval of time, since we are sowing more than two crops, right? So there are chances of getting one after the another harvesting. So he may get a more economical benefit in a case of a mixed cropping. And another advantage of mixed cropping is it maintains the soil fertility, right? Like one crop will utilize the phosphorus, another crop may utilize the nitrogen as a nutrition. So here there is no competition for the nutrition between the crops, since each one of them utilize the different nutrients. So the soil fertility will be maintained by the mixed cropping. The third type of a cropping system is a multi-cropping. So here we have a multi-cropping. What do you mean by it? Multi-cropping is planting of 2 to 4 crops. Here we are going to plant 2 to 4 crops during the same year in the same field. Yes, we will grow 2 to 4 crops during the same year and the same field is called as a multiple cropping. Here, we have to understand the small differences between a mixed cropping and multiple cropping. The multiple cropping is quite similar to mixed cropping, but here we will follow a certain pattern to sow the crops. Yes, whereas in mixed cropping, we do not follow any pattern to sow the crops. So here you can see they are following a row patterns. They are following a row pattern to grow the crops. So this is a basic difference. And multi-cropping is also called as an intercropping. Multi-cropping is also called as an intercropping. Multi-cropping is only possible when we plant crops that require planting for a shorter period of time. So here we will follow the multi-cropping. When do we follow the multi-cropping? Only when we crop the plants that require the planting for a shorter period of time. That is, we can harvest them very earlier. So we require a shorter period of time. Then only multi-cropping system. What type of a farming that is a organic farming? What do you mean by a organic farming? Here, very important it is, its organic farming works in conjunction with nature and is not opposed to it. It targets high quality crop yields through the use of various techniques. Yes. So till now, whatever we studied is a type of a cropping system. Let us understand the terminology. What do you mean by organic farming? Organic farming is a type of a farming where we do not go against the nature. It works in conjunction with the nature. What do you mean by it? It means that in organic farming, they do not use any chemical fertilizers. They do not use any pesticides. They do not use any insecticides. No chemicals are being used in organic farming. Then how do they control the pests and insects? So here, the organic farming is being followed by the help of biofertilizers. They use biofertilizers, or else they use the green manure. Like green manure, which has been obtained by the leguminous plants, or biofertilizers. For example, you can say rhizobium, right? As we already know about rhizobium. So, or you can say vermicompost. They do not use any chemicals. So farming which is being followed without use of a chemical is called as a organic farming. That is, it is works in conjunction with the nature. So such kind of farming is called as a organic farming. Okay, we understood the four types of systems of method of cropping. Next, we will go for very important terminology, that is a horticulture. What do you mean by horticulture? Horticulture includes the gardening of the fruits and vegetables. So very simple, it is also a branch of agricultural science. It is also a branch of agricultural science. But in horticulture, they always target for gardening of the fruits and vegetables. That is, always the edible crops are being grown, or as you can say, ornamental plants are grown. They doesn't follow any the management of the farms, or they doesn't follow any the management of the cattle or animals. They only follow the gardening of the fruits and vegetables and some ornamental plants. So you can see here at the right side. So it is one of a horticulture field, right? So here they are only targeting the gardening of the fruits, vegetables, and some of the ornamental plants. So such kind of field of science, we call it as a horticulture. We will understand the most important terminology concerned with the agriculture is a transplantation. What do you mean by transplantation? So when we come to the field of agriculture, it is different. The transplantation is the process of shifting the new plants from the field where they were sown to the main field is called transplantation. Yes, like we will buy some of the plants, right, in the market, and then we will sow them to our main field, right? So this is the process where the plants are being sown, the new plants which are being sown at one particular pot, and they were being transferred to the main field. They were being transferred to the main field, and this process is called as a transplantation. So next important concept, that is a plant growth regulators. Very important. What are the plant growth regulators? So these are the chemicals. They are the chemicals that control the rate of growth of plants. They control the rate of growth of plants are called as a plant growth regulators. So what do you mean by rate of growth of plants? Say for example, the root has to grow at a particular time. The shoot has to grow, the flower has to blossom, right? The stem has to elongate. So for the root to grow, we have a particular chemical. So you say at the right side, the most important examples for the plant growth regulators, they are also called as a plant growth hormones. We can also call them as a plant growth hormones. That is auxin. You can see here. Auxin, right? So what is this auxin? It is a kind of a growth hormone which promote the root initiation. So it will help for the roots to grow. So that is auxin. Secondly, we have cytokinin. You can see here that is a cytokinin. It is also a kind of a growth regulator. It is meant to induce the growth of shoot. To induce, that is to start the growth of the shoot, that is a cytokinin. Thirdly, we have gibberellin, another growth regulator, that is a gibberellin. What is the job of a gibberellin? To elongate the cell. What is its job? It is to elongate the, stimulate the cell. So it is basically involved for the elongation of the stem, you can say, or else it is also meant for the cell elongation. Lastly, we have fluorigen. What is the job of a fluorigen? It triggers the blossoming. It is basically involved in the blossoming of the flowers. So these are some of the four important, we have still more many growth regulators. The most important plant growth regulators are auxin, cytokinin, gibberellin, and the fluorigen. Now we will understand the concept of irrigation. So what do you mean by irrigation? Irrigation is necessary for the proper growth of crops. Yes, it is the most important step, you can say, in agriculture for the proper growth of the crops. What do you mean by irrigation? That is a supply of water to the field. In another way, we can say it is a supply of water to the field for the growth of the crops, right? So here at the right side, we have types of irrigation. Just let us glance on them. The type of or methods of irrigation, that is, we can go for sprinkle irrigation, right? Sprinkler irrigation. The first one is a sprinkler irrigation. The water has been sprinkled. It has been sprinkled. Next is a drip irrigation, right? Next one is a drip irrigation where the water has been supplied drop by drop. So it always keeps the land wet. It always keeps the land wet. Thirdly, we have surge irrigation. We have surge irrigation. What do you mean by surge irrigation here? The water is being supplied at the furrow. You can see there. You know furrows, right? Where the beds are being constructed, at the furrows, they supply the water. So that is a surge irrigation. Lastly, we have a flood irrigation. What do you mean by flood irrigation? Where excess of water is being required to the field, then we go for a flood irrigation. So these are some of the four important methods of a irrigation. Okay, we will go understand what do you mean by organic manure, right? Organic manures. Organic manures are the all these natural ingredients, right? You can see at the right side diagram, all these natural ingredients, except the water. It doesn't include the water, which increase soil fertility. What is the job of organic manures? They always increase the soil fertility when mixed with the soil. Yes, when all these natural waste, you can say, what does the organic manure include? All the natural waste, kitchen waste, you can say, or the remains of the birds, right? Or animal waste, right? So when these waste, but except water, even the leaves litter, that is dried leaves. So when all this waste has been dumped in a soil, when it is mixed with the soil, it increases the soil fertility. That is nothing but called as organic manure. So one such of organic manure, that is a vermicompost. We'll understand very important concept, vermicompost. What is this? Vermicompost is also called earthworm culture manure. Yes, it is also called as a earthworm culture manure, or it is also called as a vermiculture. One more name for the vermicompost is a vermiculture. Earthworms are usually termed as the true friends of the farmers, or they are also known as the natural plowers. So you might have learned about the vermicompost. What is vermicompost? It is a compost which is being synthesized with the help of the earthworms. Usually the earthworms will increase the fertility of the soil, and they also help for the water holding capacity of the soil. So such kind of manure or the waste which is being obtained from the earthworm is vermicompost. Now we will understand. We understood about organic manure and one of the example in that is a vermicompost. Now we will move to the fertilizers. What do you mean by fertilizers? So here, fertilizers are the chemical substances. So these are chemical substances basically, which are supplied to the crops to increase their productivity. So fertilizers are the chemical substances supplied to the crops to increase their productivity. NPK is the name for the prominent fertilizer. So you might have seen some of the fertilizer packets with naming as NPK. What does this NPK stands for? N for nitrogen, P for phosphate, and K for potassium. Why K for potassium? Because the Latin name for potassium is a kalium. The Latin name for potassium is a kalium. So we take it as a K. right? So the fertilizer packets always consist of nitrogen, phosphates, and the potassium, which is most required for the plant growth. So basically, fertilizers are the chemical substances. So next we will understand the insect plants in three ways. So we will apply the fertilizers, we use the compost, we use the vermicompost. Why? Because for the growth, proper growth of the plants. But at the same time, insect pest will attack the plants in three ways. How do they attack? Firstly, they cut off the roots, branches, and the leaves. The first main target of the insect pest is roots, branches, and the leaves. Secondly, they suck the cellular fluid from the various parts of the plants. Yes, they make the plants dry. Basically, they make the plants dry. They take the succulent fluids, the cellular fluids from the various parts of the plants. And thirdly, they make the holes in the branches and the fruits. So this is how the insect pest will attack the plants in these three ways. So we learned about how to protect the plants and what kind of the manures and what do you mean by fertilizers, what are the methods of irrigation. We will move further after the harvesting of the crops, how to store the grain, right? That is storage of grains. How can we store them? We have some of the methods. The first and foremost method is by drying. We can store the grain by drying. The grains can be dried in the sun, or it can be dried by exposing it to hot or warm air. Okay, so the grains has to be dried, because if there is a presence of a moisture, there is a chances of growing of microorganism activity. So there should not be a minute of moisture content in the grains. So the grains has to be dried naturally. That is, they can be dried in the sun or they can be dried in a hot or warm air. So at the right side, you can see the huge amount of grains are being dried under the hot sun. The next method of storage of the grain is by maintenance of the storage vessels. So you can also store the grains under a storage vessels. The godown, sacks, tanks, or vessels. So these can be used for the storage of a grain. So they should not have cracks or holes in them. So we should see that there should not be any cracks or holes while storing the grains, and they should be clean. So whenever you want to store the grains in a storage vessels, they can be stored either in a godown. You can see there, they are being stored in a godown in the form of a bags, right? Or you can store them in the sacks or in a tanks or in a vessels, provided the whenever you store the grains, the place has to be very clean. And whenever you store in a vessels or a tanks, there should not be any holes or a cracks. You can also store the grains by the help of a chemical treatment. So how it is? There is a sprinkling of insecticides and fungicides, chemicals, on the godowns, and the storage vessels is known as a chemical treatment. Not only storing them in a clean vessels and the clean godowns, you can also follow the chemical treatment where the sprinkling of the insecticides and fungicides. What are these insecticides and fungicides? Insecticides are the one which will kill the insects. Fungicides are the chemicals which kills the fungi. They do not allow the insect and the fungi activities. So these kind of chemicals should be sprinkled on the godowns and the storage vessels to keep the grains clean. Grain is also treated. We can either go for chemical treatment, or grain is also treated with the neem leaves. You can also go by the natural method, like by treating them with the neem leaves, black pepper, and oil. This is an organic cure. So this is one of a organic cure that is without using the chemicals, right? This is an organic cure that prevents insects from ovulating. So what do you mean by ovulating? That doesn't allow the laying of eggs of the insects. So either you can go for chemical method or you can go by a organic method to prevent the deterioration of the grains. Okay, so till now we studied about the food production and the storage of the grains. Let us move to the next important concept, animal husbandry. What do you mean by animal husbandry? Animal husbandry is that branch of science which is concerned with the management of various methods of better production of food items and procurement of better services from animals. So here, basically, animal husbandry is concerned with the management of the animals, rearing of the animals for the better production of the food items and better services from the animals. So whenever we say animal husbandry, it is not concerned with any single animal. It may be any animals, right? Like it may be a pigs or it may be a hens or it may be a cattle, right? So on the whole, we call it as an animal husbandry. So let us understand in animal husbandry a particular, that is a poultry farming. So what is this poultry farming? Poultry farming is a form of animal husbandry which raises domesticated birds. Basically, it raises what? A domesticated birds such as chickens, ducks, turkeys and geese. So why do they raise the domesticated birds? To produce meat or eggs, to produce the meat or eggs for food poultry farming, and not only contributing to the better quality of food but is also a major source of income. So here, poultry farming, basically it is concerned with the raising of a domesticated birds. So what is the purpose of raising the domesticated birds in a such a large scale is because to provide a meat and eggs, not only for the meat and eggs, but also it is a major source of income. So they follow the poultry farming. Next, we will see the fishery and the aquaculture. So, fish is a rich source of protein in our diet. Fisheries can be both freshwater fisheries and marine fisheries. So, this is another kind of husbandry, you can say, where they are going to, that is, rear the fishes, right? So, here the fishes are being obtained, it may be from the fresh water or it may be from the marine water, since they are a rich source of protein. Okay, so till now we saw some of the types of animal husbandry. Let us understand the most important concept, that is, what do you mean by biotechnology, right? So here, when the plant cells or tissues, that is, what do you mean by tissue? The collection of cells together form the tissues. When plant cells, tissues and plant parts are used to drive useful products by mixing them with the nutrients in a test tube or a beaker, it is termed as biotechnology. So here, what is biotechnology? It is basically a branch of science. Where we are using the plant cells, tissues or the plant parts, right, to make a useful products by applying the technology. So what is here technology? Where we are growing them in test tubes or a beakers. We are growing them in a test tubes or a beakers, not on the field. We are making a useful products in a test tubes or the beakers with the help of a nutrients. So here we are applying the technology in the field of a biology. So it is called as a biotechnology. So in the biotechnology, we have a branch of agricultural biotechnology. right? So what this agriculture biotechnology again can be of two types. Again, it has a two types. What are those? That is, it may be a tissue culture, that is tissue culture or cellular culture. And secondly, very important, that is genetic engineering. These are the two branches of, again, that is a agricultural biotechnology. So let us understand, what do you mean by tissue culture? What do you mean by genetic engineering? So here, tissue culture, it involves separating of a plant cells and tissues and culturing them in a nutrient media, in a test tubes or a beakers. So basically, a tissue culture lab or a tissue culture branch involves the growing of the plants or the parts of a plants in a test tubes. You can say in vitro. What do you mean by in vitro? We are growing the plants in a lab. We are growing the plants in a test tube. So you can see at the right side, right? There, they are growing the plants in a test tube, providing them a particular nutrient media. So this science, branch of science which deals with the growing of a plants in a test tubes is a tissue culture. The next branch of the agricultural biotechnology is a genetic engineering. So what is this genetic engineering? It is a transfer of a specific gene. It is a transfer of a specific gene or DNA. So what is DNA? You know that it is one of a genetic material. Deoxyribose nucleic acid. What is DNA? Deoxyribose nucleic acid. So the transfer of specific gene or a DNA from a plant into the cells of another plant, from a plant to a cells of another plant through the use of recombinant DNA technology. Through the use of a recombinant DNA technology, such plants are called transgenic plants. Such kind of plants are called transgenic plants. So in genetic engineering, it is a field of a biotechnology where we can produce a transgenic plants. So here we can produce the plants of a particular character. We can produce the plants of a particular character. Say for example, if we don't want the coconut tree of such a height, right? We can induce a specific gene of a dwarfism in them. So this transfer of a gene from one plant to the another plant, right, is being done with the help of a technique called as a recombinant DNA technology. And such kind of plants are called as a transgenic plants. Say we have a hybrid tomato. Nowadays we have a tomato, right, which have a very hard shell. They do not detoil very easily. So this hardness is again by the help of a transgenic plants. So this has been done by a field called as a genetic engineering, where we transfer a specific gene. So here at the right side, I'm showing the diagram. The ladder-like structure is nothing but it is a DNA, right? So this gene is been transferred to the plants. So this mode of transformation is by the recombinant DNA technology, and the branch is called as a genetic engineering. Okay, we'll understand some more concepts. Like, what do you mean by food security, right? So till now we learned about food production, animal husbandry. Let us understand what do you mean by food security. It is defined as convenient available of food. It is defined as timely and convenient availability of food for all the people of a particular region or a country. Say for example, some of the crops have been provided at some season. So what do you mean by food security? It should be seen that there should be a timely and convenient availability of the food to all the regions or a country. So this is called as a food security. Next we have minimum support price. So here the farmers are paid a predetermined sum of their crops. This sum is called as a minimum support price. So most of the farmers will see the loss whenever there is a huge flood, right? So there may be a loss to them. So they lose their life, most of them. So here the government is providing a minimum support price to the farmers where they pay a predetermined sum of their crops, right? Whatever the price is there, they provide a predetermined sum for their crops to the farmers, and it is called as a minimum support price. Next one is a buffer stocks. What do you mean by buffer stocks? These are the stocks of grains. So the stocks of grains that are being obtained by the government. So here the government will obtain a stock of grains through the medium of a Food Council of India. So here the government will obtain some stocks of grains before from the farmers and provide to the people or a public whenever there is a scarcity of the grains. So such kind of obtaining of a crops through the medium, how they obtain? Through the medium of a FCI, that is Food Council of India. So that is called as a buffer stock. Such kind of stocks of grains are called as a buffer stocks. Okay, we'll move to the question answers. The study of field crops is called, pomology, or it is agronomy, or olericulture, or it is a floriculture. So we have studied it. Okay, we got from Kavya, agronomy. So study of field crops is called pomology, agronomy, olericulture, or it's a floriculture. So any more answers? From Kavya, we got agronomy. Okay. So we'll see the answer. Yes. That is a second option. Exactly. That is a agronomy. Agronomy is a branch of agriculture science. We studied about it already, right? That deals with the study of crops. It deals with the study of crops and soils in which they grow. Agronomists work to develop the methods that will improve the use of soil and increase the production of food and fiber crops. Okay. Select the biofertilizer in the following, right? We studied about biofertilizer in organic farming. So let us identify which of this is a biofertilizer. Is it compost or ammonium sulfate, cattle dung, or algae and blue-green algae? From Suma Basavaraju, we got that is a third option, cattle dung. So they are asking biofertilizer. What do you mean by biofertilizer? Bio means organism. Fertilizer is the one which increases the fertility of the soil, right? So out of this, which is a biofertilizer? Compost, ammonium sulfate, cattle dung, algae and blue green algae. So I have given one example already for the biofertilizer. So any more answers? Okay, from Kavya, we got compost. Okay. Fine. Like I have given you an example of a rhizobium, right? From Lakshmi RG, we got compost. Okay. Bio means organism. Fertilizer is the one which increases the fertility. So which is a biofertilizer? Fine. So we will see the answer. It is algae and blue-green algae. See here, it is a organism. Bio means organism. Fertilizer which increases the fertility. So let us see how it is. A biofertilizer is a substance which contains the living organism. Very important. It contains the living organism, which when applied to the seed, plant surfaces or the soil, colonizes the rhizosphere. What do you mean by rhizosphere? That is a sphere of the roots. That is a rhizosphere, or the interior of the plants and promotes the growth by increasing the supply or availability of the primary nutrients to the host plant. So here biofertilizer means it should contain any living organism. Say for example, rhizobium bacteria, which will fix the nitrogen in a leguminous plant. So it is an example for a biofertilizer. So here algae is a kind of a organism, you can say. So it is a kind of a biofertilizer. Through photosynthesis, green plants generate. What do they generate? Do they generate inorganic materials or minerals, organic materials or nutrients? From Harshita J, we got that is nutrients. From Suma Baswarajo, we got nutrients. From Kavya, it is organic material. Very good. Nutrients are the one which are supplied to the soil. From Sri Raksha, we got organic materials. Varsha, organic materials. Super. Very good. Okay. Okay, Chandrika, fine. Shalini, we got organic material, fine. See, nutrients may be inorganic material, organic material, or it may be mineral. So Divya, we got minerals, okay, fine. See, what photosynthesis, we know this is one of the basic process in a green plants. So it doesn't generate organic material, inorganic material, minerals or nutrients. Yes, option third, that is organic material. Most of you people has chosen third option. Organic material is the right answer. Photosynthesis, yes, it is in a green plants, harnesses energy of sunlight. It will harness the energy of sunlight to convert carbon dioxide, water and minerals into organic compounds. Very important, into organic compounds and gaseous oxygen. The principal organic product of photosynthesis, right, which is the most important organic product, it is carbohydrates. Basically they produce the carbohydrates, that is formation of glucose. Plants produce what? Formation of glucose. It can be shown by the equation. So what is the equation of photosynthesis? That is 6CO2, that is carbon dioxide, when combines with the 12H2O water molecule, it gives the glucose C6H12O6, that is glucose, and release of oxygen 6O2 plus H2O water. So here the organic material which is being generated by the green plants is the glucose. So it right answer is an organic material. Green manure is obtained from, yes, green manure is obtained from, is it from fresh animal excreta, or is it decomposing green legume plants, or is it domestic vegetable waste, or is it a oil seed husk cakes? Okay, so here you have to be very precise. They are asking green manure, right? They're asking not only organic manure, it is a green manure. So is it obtained from a fresh animal excreta, decomposing green legume plants? Kavya, okay, very good. We got second option from Kavya. Decomposing green legume plants, domestic vegetable waste, or oil seed husk cakes. Okay, from Suma Basavaraju, we got second option. Decomposing green legume plant. From Varsha, it is second. Okay. Shalini, second option. Okay, Hafsa, it is option two. Okay, fine. Fine. So from Chandrika, option two. Yes, it is obviously the second option, decomposing green legume plants. So since it is a green manure, we will obviously get from the decomposing green legume plants. Green manure is obtained from the decomposing green legume plants. Which of the following is a correct description of a tissue culture? Right. So we learned about plant tissue culture, right? So which is a correct description of it? Let us go through them. Is it a conservation of forest and plantation? Is the tissue culture is the conservation of a forest and plantation? Secondly, is it a growth and propagation of a horticulture crops? Or thirdly, it is a science of cultivating animal tissue in artificial medium. Yes. Lastly, we have protection of a wild animals. Okay. Very fast, Kavya, we got third option. Science of cultivating animal tissue in artificial medium. So here you should see that they are not asking particularly plant tissue culture. Okay, from Tulasi, Vaishnav, we got third option. They're asking tissue culture. Harshita, third option. Okay, Chandrika, second option. So think of it, why Chandrika is second. Okay, Hafsa, third option. Pooja, we got third. Superb. So we learned about tissue culture, right? From Ashwini. Okay, Bhavna, we got third option. Superb. So it is the third or answer third, that is science of cultivating animal tissue in artificial medium. We have seen, right? We are growing different parts of a plants in an artificial medium, in a test tube and beaker. So that is nothing but called as a tissue culture. So let us go through it. Tissue culture is the growth of tissues or the cells separate from the organism. This is typically facilitated via use of liquid, semi-solid or solid growth medium such as broth or agar. So here the medium which has been used for the growth of the tissues is a broth or agar. In modern usage, tissue culture generally refers to the growth of cells from a tissue from a multicellular organism in vitro. So here we are growing the tissue from a multi-organism in vitro. What do you mean by in vitro? That is in a lab. In vitro means outside. That is in a lab or laboratory. Pigeon milk is produced by very interesting concept. Pigeon milk is produced by is this produced by crop or birds, mammals or all of the above? Okay. Suma Basuraju, we got from birds. Okay, superb. From Suma Basuraju, we got the second option, birds. Chandana, mammals. Kavya, crop. Okay. Harshita, Kavya, we got crop. Okay. The name itself suggests. Okay, Shalini, from the second option, it is from birds. From Varsha, we got second option. Pooja, crops. Okay. We got crop. Okay. So it is from the birds. So pigeon milk. Okay. From Fatima, fourth. Let us go through them. Let us understand what you mean by pigeon milk. Crop milk is the secretion from the lining of the crop of a parent bird that is regurgitated to the young birds. So this is a very important concept. So it is one of a milk which is being produced from the lining of a crop of a parent bird to the young birds. They are usually found among all the pigeons and does. So pigeon milk is nothing but it is produced from the pigeons and does, where they are referred to as pigeon milk. So it is called as a crop milk. Why we have, it is very important in this concept because it is also called as a crop milk. Do not get confused since it is produced from the crops. No, crop milk is also produced by the flamingos and some of the penguins. So what do you mean by crop here? Crop is doesn't mean that it is a grain. No, crop is nothing but it is an elementary canal of the pigeons. What do you mean by crop? It is the elementary canal. What is the elementary canal? That is a neck of the pigeons. You might have seen, right? It is produced from the neck of the pigeon, so it is called as a crop milk. It is not produced from the crops. It is produced from the pigeons. Natural organic fertilizers are found to be better than the chemical fertilizers because, right? They are better than the chemical fertilizers. Why? First one, chemical fertilizers are less productive. Secondly, organic fertilizers are more productive. Organic fertilizers sustain the soil productivity. So soon we are getting answers from this one, third option. Okay. Chemical fertilizers are toxic. Okay, from Varsha we got fourth option. Kavya, third option. Okay, from Hafsa we got option three. Superb. If the chemical fertilizers are toxic, there won't be any chemical fertilizers at all. From Fatima we got fourth option. We are using chemical fertilizers, right? Like NPK. Shalini, fourth option. Think over it. But they are better than the organic fertilizers. What is the reason? From Varsha, we got that is organic fertilizers sustain soil productivity. Okay, let us see the answer. So it is obviously third option. They sustain the soil productivity. Organic fertilizers like compost are either soil conditioners or growth enhancers. They sustain crop yields and soil productivity in intensive cropping systems, which leave low organic residues on the soil. Say they always improve the fertility of the soil, that is organic fertilizers. So they are better than the chemical fertilizers. The method not used as a biological control is use of predators of a pest. Is it pheromone traps or use of pesticides or use of neem extracts? Kavya, third option. Which of the method not used as a biological control? Okay, use of pesticides, that is third option from Fatima we got. Very good. Divya, use of pesticides. Super. Third option, Pooja. Okay, Chandrika, option three. Okay, super. From Ashwini, fourth option. Why neem is not a biological control? Fine. They are asking not used as a biological control. Fine. So it's option three, that is use of pesticide. So here, pesticides are the substances or a mixture of substances intended for preventing, destroying, repelling or mitigating any pest. So here pesticides are basically the chemicals. They are not under the biological control, right? So pesticides are a special kind of products for crop production. So it is use of pesticides. BT seed is associated with, is it associated with the rice, wheat, cotton or oil seeds? So BT seeds, so there was a major breakthrough. Yes, very good. From Divya we got cotton, it is general. Kavya, cotton, super. Shalini, third option. Chandana, third. Sri Raksha. Okay, so most of them are going for the option three. That is obviously BT seed is concerned with the cotton. Ashwini, option three. Fine. So cotton is the most popular of a BT crops. It was planted on about 1.8 million acres. That is, you can say 7,28,437 hectares. In the year of 1996 and 1997, the BT gene was isolated and transferred from a bacterium, that is Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a bacteria. BT is because of Bacillus thuringiensis, to an American cotton. The American cotton was subsequently crossed with the Indian cotton to to introduce the gene into the native varieties. So it is called as BT cotton. A large number of identical plants can be obtained in a short span of time through. How can we obtain a large number of identical plants? That is, large number of seeds of a single plant, or is it by stem cuttings, or is it by a tissue culture technique, or is it by hydroponics method? So how can we obtain large number of identical plants? Yes, from Kavya we got option 3, tissue culture technique. Tulasi, fourth option. Okay, Chandana, fourth. Hafsa, we got option 3. Okay, so obviously, yes, it is option 3, tissue culture technique. Plant tissue culture is a collection of a technique used to maintain or grow plant cells, tissues, or the organs under sterile conditions or on a nutrient medium of known composition. Plant tissue culture is widely used to produce the clones of a plant in a method known as micropropagation. Which one of the following animals is called as a farmer's friend? Is it an ant, earthworm, bee, or butterfly? So very, yes, very good. We got so many options we are getting. That is option 2. Yes, it is obviously the option 2, that is earthworm. Organic fertilizers like compost are either soil conditioners or growth enhancers. They sustain crop yields and soil productivity in intensive cropping system, which leave low organic residues on the soil. What is farming along with animal husbandry called? Okay, is it called as mixed farming or mixed agriculture, or is it a dairy farming, or it is a truck farming? Okay, from Varsha we got C option, dairy farming. Okay, yes, from Fatima we got first option, mixed farming. Super. Pooja, mixed farming. Okay, from Chandrika we got mixed farming. Okay, Chandana first option, Varsha first option. Okay, so we'll see the answer. Hafsa also. Okay, it's called as a mixed farming. What is mixed farming? If it is farming along with the animal husbandry, we call it as a mixed farming. Study of internal structure of plant. So what it is called as? Is it a morphology, or is it an anatomy, or ecology, or it is taxonomy? Yes, from Kavya we got anatomy. Bhavana, see. Okay, morphology. Okay, some of the people are giving morphology, anatomy. From most of the people are giving option 2, anatomy. Chandana, yes. Divya also, yes. It is a anatomy. It is a branch of a science which deals with the study of internal structure of a plant, called as a anatomy. Study of growing plant without soil in water containing nutrient is, okay, is it called as a hydrotonics, or is it as a hydroponics, or hypotonics, or is it is a none of this? Okay, very good. From Kavya we got second option, hydroponics. Hydroponic from the Tulasi. Okay, Sri Raksha. Fatima, okay. Varsha, okay. We got second option from Varsha also. So let us see the answer. So it is the option B, that is hydroponics. Hydroponics is a type of a horticulture and a subset of a hydroculture, which is a method of growing plants, usually crops, without soil. Very important. They grow the plants without the soil. It is called as a hydroponics. By using the nutrient mineral nutrient solutions in the aqueous solvent. Plant which grow in a saline soil are, so plants which grow in a saline soil, that is a soil which consists of salt content. Thus, they are called as xerophytes, hydrophytes, halophytes, or succulents. Okay, we got from Kavya, that is halophytes. Superb. Okay. Fazia, Fatima, option 2, hydrophytes. Chandrika, option 3, Tulasi, halophytes. Okay. So, five stands for plants. Okay. So, you should go through the first terminology. Is it a zero, hydro, halo, or succulents? So, from Hafsa, we got option 3, halophytes. Okay. So, let us see the answer. So, it is the option C. It is halophytes. So, zero stands for the one which do not have water, right? When they grow in a dry condition, zero. Hydro, water. Halo means it is a soil. Succulents, always there is a presence of a moisture content. They are the succulents. So, xero, hydrophytes, halophytes, and succulents. Okay, so we move to the conclusion part. So, in this chapter you learned, discuss about the principles of crop production and explain the methods of crop production, including organic farming. We also explained the methods of protection of crops from insects and weeds. How can we protect them, right? And we appreciate the value of animal husbandry, poultry, and fisheries as an income generating activities. And we give the credence to the use of both modern technology and genetic engineering, thus removing the barrier between science and society in the process. And we describe the link between production, storage, and distribution. So these are some of the concepts we learned in today's class. So if you have any queries concerned to this chapter, please welcome. Any doubts or queries? Please visit edurapid.com website and go through the videos and questions. Okay, thank you, Suma. So, any questions, please, you are welcome. Okay. Thank you. Thank you all.